Let's jump right into the 2005 WRX stereo. This was an audio integrations amp rack, which went under the rear deck. So you would mark your holes here. You would drill holes right into that underneath your deck area to put some nut expanding rubber nuts, which you'd see. So you can see my bigger holes here. And you could see that it sit right in there. And next pick probably shows you the expanding nuts that we use right there. So as you tighten it, it would expand the nut, much like our new license plate holders that we've used. And you'd put it up in there, and it was a way to mount this, your amps, out of the way, right up in the deck. Now you can see there wasn't a whole lot of room there. You need a pretty small amp to be able to fit in there. We'll show you some of the amps I chose. Underneath that deck, I went with the distributor for the power and ground. And I have some Alpine PDX, which were some of the smallest amps. They weren't good sounding amps or powerful, but they were just convenient at that time. And so I mounted those all up, got them all wired, and I swung it up, and then it would latch, of course, upwards, so it would be out of the way. And that shows a little remote wire I had teed in there, and I would screw it up once you're done and expand the other front nut to hold it up inside there. And that amp just fit. I had to move the amp inward a tiny bit to get it to clear the edge of that deck. And we've already seen this one probably, or this is similar with the power and ground actually attached. And more holes drilled for my second amp on this audio integrations rack. And you can see here with it up, it kind of freed up your trunk a little bit, but it was a little bit messy. Then I did the dynamat of the whole rear, of course, the trunk, the spare tire. I didn't do like any of the front areas. I did do the doors. You'll see that later. Just a little bit of dynamat to take out some of the vibration there. And even the outer panels here, inner and outer panels in the trunk. If I had the dynamat, I figured I might as well use it, right? So I didn't do the center of the wheel well because it just wasn't very necessary. I was just getting all the surrounding parts for my subs that I was going to have in there later. I did do the front doors too. You can see Alpine Type S coaxials, which were much early in my builds before I got all kinds of serious with all the next stuff you're going to see. So I just kind of piecemealed it together, which works just as good, just to take off the general vibrations all around. One of the first amps I got for this was a Macintosh off eBay. This is a different Macintosh than the one you saw in the other video. This was a smaller Macintosh. It was either 2x80 or 2x50, something like that. But again, Macintosh was just beautiful stuff. It was just so clean and so powerful. I could probably see it right here. It was a 50 watt minimum, and it just got verified. But that's an incredibly clean 50 watt. You know, that'll sound like 100 watt of a crappy amp. Or even, that'll sound like 200 watt off a crappy amp. It was just so clean. Then I went to Audio Integrations rear seat rack design instead. Same company. This was more of a showpiece, a little bit cleaner, I'd say. I started with some CDT audio speakers, which I didn't end up liking too much. I had an Alpine power amp here for my subs. Macintosh was running the doors and the fronts kind of thing. So you'd lay out all your amps, cut your holes in the back where you needed to put your wires through, kind of like that. Had all the wires hidden right through little holes right there. And you would then mount it here and bolt it to the rails behind your rear seat, which you'll see probably at some point. And this was without it. Here you can see how it attached to those stock rails. Those black rails are stock, so it would attach there, and you'd have a real nice looking amp layout right there. That looked pretty professional. And I did try a few other amps you're going to see also in this setup. Those were the CDD tweets when I was trying some different configuration spots for these. I don't know what that is right there. Probably another tweet shot. A JL Audio 10W6. You know, I had the zeros, threes, and sevens, and I had a six I tried also. But I always liked the tighter threes in a dual set rather than one single more high quality sub. CDT Audio was nothing special in my opinion. That was kind of the first set I bought, and I sold them pretty quick. And I moved up to a little more fancy stuff after that. Here you can see where I mounted the crossover, so the back of the rack. That would have been with 3M tape. I wasn't going to drill holes all over this thing. It was fiberglass, so you can see it kind of spattered. That's another place where I mounted a CDT tweet on both before I kind of went with a different setup on those tweets. And my 10W6 in another Audio Integrations sub box, which centered into the corner there. So you probably see a complete pick in a minute right there of how the whole package looked. You did lose a lot of trunk with this sub box here. And we're going to look at the porting of the rear deck also, just to let the bass through. So I was measuring up and cutting out holes in the rear deck, and I got a mini port tube, which you'll see, which didn't have any function in a ported sense, but it did let a lot of sub through into the cabin. What you were looking at here is the True Technology amp. The first picture was a little blurry. Built-in fans into the heat sinks. This is a newer True Technology amp than the one in the other video you saw. This was newer, a newer product line. This amp was about $800-$900. It was, I think it was 4x65 watt, but I mean, it's just magical sound. It might sound like ridiculous, but you don't get amps that are really cleaner than this and perform perfectly. Super strong transient response, super highs, super lows, just everything flawless. You had the transistors showing there too. I also tried an Image Dynamics V3, I believe, at some point, which I liked more. It got a lot louder than that 10W6 because, of course, it was more sensitive. And my Pioneer PRS720s, probably my second favorite speaker of all time after the Focal Kevlars. These had sub-like bass in the front. I had to make gigantic adapters for these. The tweeters were the most musical I've ever felt. If you can ever find a set of used, something like T720-PRS, and it has to be the 6.5s, not the 5s or something. These were just really incredible speakers, gigantic passive crossover, really high quality. Look at the size of those magnets. That's just ridiculous. It just sounded just like subs in the front doors. And you could remove these, which I took out the screws to get a little more clearance. See, it took out just 2 or 3 millimeter. If you were that close to the window, it would be just right. And here's when I was making some plastic MDF out of HDPE, high-density plastic, which was better than MDF in a lot of ways. It wouldn't be damaged by water and things like that. And you could countersink the bolts pretty well. It's flush there. And you'd put that in, screw it behind the door panel, then you'd have your fresh bolts, just like that. It'd be attached. Then you'd pilot drill a few holes right here. And these were some spare pillars I bought because I didn't want holes drilled in the ones when I changed my placement. So I put on new A-pillars to replace the ones that I had drilled out, experimenting with some Pioneer tweeter locations here. That was just a temporary spot because it was on a rail there. Then you see the Pioneer mounted to the back of the deck. And those are probably C's Neo tweets, S-E-A-S. On the do-it-yourself sites, it's very popular. I think that's a C's Neo because I don't recognize it, and that was one of the rare ones I had. I got a Sinfoni amp, and that's up there with the Macintosh and True, in my opinion. It's an Italian amp, way overpriced and all that. This was a 45x2. I think I got this for about $400 or $500, and 45 RMS times 2 at 4 ohms. And it was a very beautiful amp. I used this for my tweets. This was just to run my tweets because my main amps were on the front side, right? So I experimented with a few different amps and a few different spots here. I think I stayed with this tweet location in the end, which was the best, up at the top of the kick there, aiming up toward my head. That was a really nice tweet location, close to the woofer on the door. So the separation was very minimal. Here you can see a very nice Alpine Type X speaker next to the PRS. I thought the Alpine Type X was going to beat out the PRS, but that wasn't the case. Let me go ahead and start this again here. I'm running out of time. So the PRS was very good, even better than these Alpines, which were already excellent. The Alpines had the best vocals, but the Pioneers had the best bass. Night and day difference. The Alpines had super pure vocals. This is an Alpine Type X tweet that I put right in the door panel here. And that's showing the rear deck with the little ports I had. You may get another port shot. There we go. Just a little port to let all that sub come into the cabin and not be blocked off. So it didn't have any traditional port technology in it. All it was just a hole, and I just finished it off nice so it looks super clean. The Image Dynamics sub, wiring that up in series, it looks like. And I did try my old True Technology amp in this car too, as you just saw. I bought this SoundStream off of eBay to test out my tweaks with it also. Old school amps is what I love. Well, I don't love them anymore. I'm not too into stereo, but back in the day. So I use that one to run my tweets for a while too. And the SoundStream, everybody knows the old SoundStream was really good stuff. The new stuff was kind of junky. It's an Alpine Type X tweeter cup right there. And that might be the Alpine tweet. No, that's the C's tweet. The C's Neo tweet, which had like a neodymium magnet, something or other. I'm not sure what all that magnet stuff is about. But there's the Alpine Type X with that beautiful finish on it. See that subwoofer, that woofer material was just such a nice finish. It wasn't paper, it wasn't cheap. And you could pull down the center here to peek at that little center amp. Another shot of the bigger True, which was a lot more power. And I had an Alpine Type R 10 that I tried. I think I tried a 12 in this thing too. My JL10W3 is my favorite of all time that were in this car. Anchored super securely. Again, I would drive the car fast. I needed the subwoofer super solid. And that's probably a 10 right there. I had a 12 in a more angled box. This was just some of my box stuffing here. These would be the Alpine tweets again, a new set. I probably damaged the set I had. Here was the speaker set I was talking to you about. TS-C720PRS is what they were called. And also, right here, the tweets for the PRS set. A lot of different ways of mounting them. And I mounted them in those Alpine cups actually a few times, just trying to see what the best way to put them was. I had them here, but as I said, I think I ended up with them in the kickers, kick panels, aiming up is what was better. So again, that's probably why I ended up buying new door panels at some point after I was done making holes in all these things. The Alpine Type X speakers here, very high-end speaker set. This was $700-$800, and of course I sold them for a small loss, but I didn't like take a half hit on them. They were almost new, and it came with all kinds of adapters on those. This was a cheaper Pioneer amp I got for my subs, and it wasn't very good. I ended up not keeping that one for whatever reason. I can't remember why I got it, but that was a very low-end amp. It wasn't nice at all. 60 watt times two, but it was also a sub amp, 150 watts. And in here was the Pioneer that I looked at. I saw those tiny little capacitors, and I said, this amp is just gonna suck. It doesn't have any beef to it, any power to it. And then I went to the Arc Audio, which was the super small footprint amps that were kind of trendy back then. Very small. This was like 75 by two, and they had a longer 75 by four. That's RMS I'm talking about. And they were tiny, tiny little amps, but they were high quality. They were high quality amps. The KS Mini series is what they were. So I actually used one of these ARCs probably for my tweet. Let's see if we have it. There it is. So I used that for the tweets in the back also at some point when I was running a full three-way setup. You see how tiny that amp is, but it was packing a lot of punch. And there's the ARC Mini drawing. You don't really need to see that. Used to order tons of stuff from Sonic Electronics. You probably heard of them. That was another one of my sub boxes that I ordered. And I was measuring the thickness of that box, and it was 1 3/4 inch plywood. Super cool. I tried some Pioneer Premier subs also, which were pretty good. They weren't quite as good as the JLW3s though, but they weren't a bad sub. It wasn't the bottom line or anything. It was a decent sub there. So I got those all wired up in the proper situations to get the ohms that I wanted, paralleling in series and then combining them and then putting them out to the box outputs to make sure that I had just the right load on the amps that I was looking for there. Those look pretty cool with the gold there too. That was a nice setup too. Specifications on this, don't need to really see that. I shouldn't have put that picture in. Here's the Alpine Type X on that custom bracket I made. And old, old pics of my Alpine coaxial stuff here too. And we're almost getting to the end. Alpine Type S. This was some of the first stuff that I installed. It's a little bit out of order. And Eclipse Point Source is another one I tried. These were rear door, now that I think about it. This was the rear door stuff I was playing with, to add speakers to the rear also. So the Point Source had a sunken tweet, so they would fit. It didn't have a tweet sticking out 2 inches from the speaker. That's why I tried out these Point Source speakers. And they did sound a little better than the Alpines, actually. And, of course, they were more expensive than the Alpines, too. Eclipse is a pretty nice speaker. It's a nice-looking woofer right there. That was nice material. I used custom adapters whenever possible. This was for the rear doors, Toyota adapters, which actually fit. You may have had to reverse the polarity of those wires out now that I think about it. This is probably an accurate date, too, 2007. It's just about the time when I was about to get rid of this car. That's when I went with the 2008 GTIs, by the way. Really nice interior and door panels there with that fabric. I like that. It's kind of like old-fashioned carbon fiber because it was soft, but it had that look to it, you know? This was before I had even ripped it apart. This is a bone stock door. Kind of going backwards in time now. There's a bone stock tweet right there. I can't imagine any of you are still sitting here listening to this freaking video. It seems it's boring the hell out of me, so I don't know about you guys. And here's where I plugged in the adapter. And probably when I mounted those Alpines. And this could be front door. I tried them on front and rear doors before I went serious with all the stuff you saw after that. And another door panel that looks like a rear door panel, I think. Yeah, those are the rear speakers, which were a little bit more simple. So you had almost no clearance. Look at that 1-inch magnet in that thing. That was no good at all. And finally, you have the Alpine and the Arc Audio comparing the size and how much small. The Alpine was already small. The Arc showed how much smaller it really was. These were like tiny, tiny amps when you needed the absolute space and clearance possible, the most space. These were tiny little amps, 125 by 2, but that was 2 ohm. It was really like a 75 by 2, 4 ohm. And the tiny little PDX series, which ended up having all kinds of static noise, not just mine, everybody. It was just a very poor line. There you can see the ported deck when I took out the deck and got that all taken care of. I trimmed those ports shorter, as you saw, just because there was no need to have them long. Showing the piece that I cut out of the deck. And factory adapters probably for Alpine that came with them that I ended up not really using. These weren't Cartboy. I did have some Cartboy adapters too, but I believe these were the Alpine adapters themselves. And they actually fit better without the adapters on them, without the plastic there. Quick shot of a KYB, which shouldn't really be in this video. KYB adjustable shocks here in the front. And C's neodymium speakers. I actually had STI springs in this car, by the way. I never mentioned that. I should have said that in the other video. And these are C's speakers right here. High quality speakers, really. And you come to the Type X crossovers, which had tons of different setups on them, tons of different configurations. You could decide exactly which phase you wanted your tweeters to be in. So these were the Type X here. I still have those Corona slippers, actually. And those would screw in or countersunk. This was probably some testing, so I had them kind of out there. I was thinking about putting them over here. And that concludes the stereo part. It was boring for me, so I'm sure it was boring for you. But if you really like stereo, maybe you were interested. Thanks a lot.